Thank you. Thank you. Oh, good morning, and welcome all to our Easter worship. And within that worship, we celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion, which all are invited in faith to receive. With thanks to the Bell Choir for playing as part of our preparation for worship on this Easter day. And as indicated in the notices there, thanks also to Liz Parker and her team of volunteers who decorated the church so beautifully for Easter. I know we have a number of visitors with us this morning for Easter worship. So if you're visiting, would you like to indicate? Lovely. So visiting from
London, Ontario.
London, Ontario. Lovely. Other visitors from. Nice to see you back. Other visitors here, some over here. Yes, visiting from?
New York.
Lovely to have you here. Any visitors? Yes.
San Diego.
From San Diego. Lovely, very nice to have you.
London, Ontario.
And London, Ontario. Do you know each other? Right. Lovely to have you. Also, here today, visitors, very good friends of mine from St Andrews, Neil Donaldson and his wife Val. This will mean more to golfers than non-golfers, I have to say, but Neil is captain of the Royal and Ancient Golf Club of St Andrews, and is visiting the Bermuda members here en route to Atlanta and then Augusta for the Masters. So, delighted to have Neil and Val with us today, members of St. Leonard's Church in St. Andrews, and a good friend have invited Neil to read the Gospel for us this morning. So, welcome all, and an invitation to refreshments, which are served outside the Thorburn and the West Hall at the close of our worship. Let us stand for the call to worship. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Hymn 410, Jesus Christ is risen today.
Thank you.
I am the living one. I was dead, and now I am alive forevermore. Let us pray. Jesus Christ, we greet you. Your hands still have holes in them, your feet are wet from the dew, and with the memory of our names, undimmed by 3 days of death, you meet us, risen from the grave. We fail to understand how, we puzzle at the reason why. But you have come not to answer our questions, but to show us your face. You are alive and the world can rejoice again. The vacant cross and the empty tomb vindicate your claim that the love which suffers is the love which saves. So fill your people with joy and your church with celebration, that the world may know that your Son Jesus is not a dead hero we commemorate, but the living Lord we worship, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be praise forever. The cross has not defeated you. The grave has not kept you silent. Through the rising of your Son from the grave, you broke the power of death and condemned death itself to die. As we celebrate this great triumph, may we also make it the model for our own living. Help us to identify in our lives all that should rightly die. Wrongdoing, tired habits, fruitless longings. Resurrect in our lives faith, hope, and love, as surely as you raised Jesus Christ from the grave. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, a world with our children and young people before they go out to all that's been organised for them for Easter Sunday. Before you leave, you're also going to listen to the gospel for today. Mark's story of the gospel, right? Mark's gospel, which tells his story of that first Easter morning. And it's interesting because it's different. It's different from the other stories. And the reason that it's different is this, that some of the women followers of Jesus go to the tomb to do what they wanted to do, and they found it empty, as the other gospel writers write. But in the other gospels, then the risen Jesus appears to them. And in Mark's gospel, nothing. Nothing. Instead, there's an angel, if you like, a messenger there, which gives them a message, tells them where he's to be. And that's it at the end of Mark's gospel. Right, in fact, we're told that the women that were there went away terrified and said nothing to anybody. Well, that's a strange ending. That's a strange ending, is it not? It's a strange ending. That's the end of the story in Mark's gospel. An empty tomb and women who kept their mouth shut. I'm not going to say anything about that. But that's the ending in Mark's gospel. Except for one thing. He makes them a promise. Now, are you ever asked to promise something? Are you ever asked to promise something? Do you promise? Do you promise? Does mum or dad ever say that? Do you promise? Any other children? Have you ever asked? Do you promise? Do you promise? And what do you say? Yes. Yes, a promise. That's what the women were given, a promise to pass on eventually to the disciples. And there's a lovely line in a song, and the grammar's not very good, so it's not my grammar, it's the song. It's the line in the song, and it's this: God don't make promises God don't keep. Right? Not very good grammar, but a very good message. God don't make promises God don't keep. And that's why we are here today, for the promises that God made, that were made through the angel, and the promises that God kept as not just these women, but some of his disciples eventually made their way to Galilee. So that's what we remember for this Easter morning, the promise of God's presence with us through Jesus. I'd say the grammar's not good, but the message is good. God don't make promises. God don't keep. Okay? We're going to hear now today's gospel. Neil.
The gospel for today is the gospel of St. Mark, chapter 16, verses 1 to 8, page 54 in your pew Bibles. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they may go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. May God bless to us his word, and to his name be the glory and praise now and forever. Amen.
Let the children go out for the anthem.
And so before the children go out, a word of blessing upon them. Loving God, as our children, as our young people go from here, may they go on this Easter day, knowing at all times in their lives, your peace, your joy, and your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Hymn 417, Now the green blade riseth from the buried grain. Hymn 417. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This morning was the most beautiful sunrise, blue sky, sun coming up over the horizon, and we had a large congregation gathered down at Elbow Beach near the sea breeze, the Lido, to celebrate that early Easter service. Shared the service with Cardinal Pettit, the priest in charge of St. Paul's. And I was conducting, and he was preaching, giving the Easter message this morning. The gospel for this Easter Sunday, and of course it changes each year, but the gospel for this year is in fact the gospel of Mark. And in a way, Aunt surprised me by saying it's his favourite Easter story, gospel story, because in general, that's not the case. People prefer Matthew or Luke or John very much over the gospel of Mark. And why is that? Well, of course, it's because in the gospel of Mark, there is no resurrection appearance. The risen Christ does not appear to these women who go first to the tomb. In Matthew's gospel, he does eventually appear to them, and then he appears later to all the disciples in Galilee and gives them the great commission. Go into all the world, making disciples, teaching them all that I have commanded you. In Luke's gospel, we have that lovely story of the Emmaus Road, of the two disciples late on Easter day in their disappointment, traveling back home to Emmaus to be joined apparently by a stranger who walks with them, explaining and expounding the Gospels. And only when they arrive at their home for the evening and he invites them, they invite him to stay on with him, and he breaks bread. Only at that point do they recognize that the risen Christ has appeared within them. And then, of course, the Gospel which is always the option for Easter morning is John's Gospel and Mary Magdalene in the garden, who goes on her own in her grief. And the risen Christ appears to her and she fails to recognize him. Thinks it's the gardener. And asks, what have you done? What have you done with his body? And it's only when he speaks to her and addresses her, Mary, that she recognizes that this is the risen Christ before her. So as a consequence of that, people generally prefer Matthew, Luke, or John, because the risen Christ appears. In Mark's gospel, this strange ending. The women go to the tomb, it's empty, they're given this message, and they leave terrified, tending initially to say nothing to anybody. If some of us find that today an unsatisfactory ending, well, so it was found unsatisfactory by the early church. If you look at your Bibles, if you look at Mark's Gospel, after verse 8, you'll find there's a short ending and a longer ending. And scholars absolutely agreed that these were added at a much later date. Just unhappy, obviously, the early church that Mark's Gospel ended the way that it did. Just as I say, if you were to summarize it, it would be an empty tomb. Mark's Gospel ends with an empty tomb and fearful woman saying nothing, which is a kind of strange ending. And so perhaps we have to focus on the message that was given to them. They say to the woman, look, they say, he has been raised, he is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. There you will see him, just as he told you. And there, if you like, is the promise. There's the promise that was given to them in his life before his death and resurrection. Go to Galilee, there you will see me, just as I tell you. It's been interpreted in kind of different ways. Go to Galilee, there you will see him, just as he told you. And there's a sense that in Mark's gospel, the disciples never get it. They never quite figure out who he is, that they're always in a bit of a haze. They don't really understand what he's saying to them. And so there's a sense in which he's told at this point, he tells them, go back to Galilee. Go back, in a sense, start again. And start again from there. And just work it through again, because this time you'll get it. This time you'll understand. And that's what they do. They go back to Galilee, and the beginning of understanding dawns upon them. And all the things that he told them and all the things that he did, in a sense, comes back. But for Mark, they have to do that to understand. They have to go back to the beginning and start again. Another way of interpreting it is this. He says, the angels say, go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you. Going ahead of you. I wonder what we make of these words. It would be perhaps a bit radical and controversial for me to suggest that the idea that somehow Jesus is with us in our lives doesn't quite fit with that text. Because what it says is not that he's with us, it says he's ahead of us. He's ahead of us. And that's what we've told to the disciples. Just go back, and as you redo that journey, he will be ahead of you. And in a sense, that is indeed part of the message of Easter, that he is constantly ahead of us. And what does that say to us? It says to us that whatever we're facing, good or bad, it might be times of celebration, it might be times of excitement, of anticipation, but wherever we are, as we move forward, he's ahead of us. And it might be times of sorrow and its suffering. It might be the bad times, the struggling times of illness or anxiety or whatever. And as we battle with that, and as we fight our way through that, we have the promise that as you move forward through that, he will be ahead of you. Ahead of you, waiting. Waiting for you to arrive, always ahead of you. There to celebrate with you, to mourn with you, to comfort you. And of course, on this Easter morning, is that not particularly true of something that we all face ultimately, and that is the inevitability and the mystery of death? That as we go into that, whatever the circumstances, whether in the course of a long and difficult illness or whether suddenly, as we approach death, he will be ahead of us, waiting. And there's a lovely picture given of the approach of death almost being the approaching to a great chasm. And as we approach that chasm, which separates us from life, as we approach it and as we go through it, what we see on the other side is the risen Christ ahead of us, waiting. And that indeed is the promise of Christ and the promise of God, that whatever we are going through, whatever it is that we're going through, good or bad, celebration or struggle, God, Christ, is ahead of us, waiting. Waiting to comfort, to heal, to celebrate, and ultimately waiting to receive us into his closer presence when our own time of death comes. And so it's a great promise, the promise of Easter, that affects and inspires our whole lives, as it was for these disciples who eventually clearly got the message from these women who were able to overcome their fear and their trauma at what they were experiencing. And so they do pass it on. And they tell the disciples, go to Galilee. He's there as he promised, ahead of you, as he is for us, which is why we are able to be here to celebrate this day. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Before our prayer of intercession, I just mentioned Friday morning was the most dreadful day in the office, church office. Everything that could go wrong did go wrong. I mean, we had Bermuda Pest Control telling us they can't do the tenting this week because it's going to be gales from Wednesday onwards. Could they start tomorrow? And the answer was no. No, you can't start tomorrow. And then Bermuda Gas came to sort the kitchen and oven and so on. And then the printer wouldn't work, right, to print the orders of service. So, with apologies, if you have looked at the In Memoriam leaflet, the flowers that have been donated in memoriam, you'll see in some of your orders of service, some of the In Memoriam, the bottom lines have been kind of half deleted, okay? So what I would do is just like to read them now, that on one page, these flowers were given by David O'Neill in memory of Boo and Brian O'Neill. And on the other page, it's in memory of our parents, Ellie and Harold Evans and X Dawson from Duncan and Sharon Lee Dawson. So apologies to them for the printer failing, but these were the flowers that were given, as well as all the others listed there. And of course, all those who are listed there and many others beside, we remember now in our prayers. Let us pray. Almighty God, on this Easter Sunday, we give thanks for all your gifts and blessings to us in life, for the beauty of this morning's sunrise, for the gift of creation, for the gift of life, for the gift of your love shown to us above all in the person of Christ. And in his name now we offer our prayers for others. We pray for our families, wherever they may be this Easter day, those with whom we will spend time and celebrate, those whom we will speak to, those whom we are unable to see at this time, and ask for the Easter blessing upon them, that they may know your peace, your joy, and your love. We pray for our friends and all who support us in our daily work and life, for those sitting around us at this time. And especially we pray for those for whom we know this is a difficult time. For those who are ill. There are those who are facing the ends of their life. We pray for them and for their families. We pray for those who feel lonely, though surrounded by others. For those who are anxious and worried. Those who find life a struggle, those in our very midst, living with homelessness, concerned about the cost of living, of unemployment. We remember them too in our prayers. We remember those unable to join us today in our residential and nursing homes who would wish to be here for Easter worship. And we pray for them and for those who care for them. And in a moment of silence, we pray each of us for those whom we know and who we want to remember in our prayers at this time, whatever their situation. In silence, we pray for them. Loving God, whatever the situation, whatever their need, we ask your blessing upon them. Where there is hurt, may they be healed. Where there is struggle, may it be overcome. And where there is sorrow, may there ultimately again be joy. And at this time, we pray for those whose lives are so very different from our own. For we have gathered in the beauty and the peace of this Easter day, there are others caught up in the trauma and the violence of war. Violence and war which so scars the beauty of this your world. And so we pray for those who govern us and who lead the nations, that they may be men and women not only of honesty and integrity, but people of reconciliation, seeking to bring reconciliation where there is presently division, and break down barriers which need to be overcome, so often the bitter legacies of history. On this Easter day, we pray for a greater peace in this, your world. And we pray for your church this Easter day. People of different nations and cultures, of histories and backgrounds and race, but united in their celebrations this day of the risen Christ and of the life that that promises. Your church placed here in the world to show how we might better learn to live together. And always in our worship we remember those who are no longer with us, but whose love we were privileged to receive and whom we remember this day. May we never think them far from us, for we share a fellowship, a communion with them still, through the mystery of that fellowship and communion that we have in you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue our worship with the giving of our offering. Let us pray. Almighty God, in your name we dedicate this, our offering, and all our offerings of our time, our talents, and our resources, praying that they may be symbols of our commitment to live in your ways and to work for the signs and the growth of your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Draw near to the holy table and hear the gracious words of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come unto me, all ye that labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. Hymn 416, Christ is alive. Let Christians sing.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, Lord God of the universe. You are the giver of this bread, fruit of the earth and of human labor. Let it become the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of the universe. You are the giver of this wine, fruit of the vine and of human labor. Let it become the wine of the eternal kingdom. As the grain once scattered in the fields and the grapes once dispersed on the hillside are now reunited on this table in bread and wine, so, Lord, may your whole church soon be gathered together from the corners of the earth into your kingdom. Let us pray. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Therefore, with your people of all places and times, and with the whole company of heaven, we proclaim your greatness and sing your praises in the angels' song. Almighty God, all power is yours. You created the heavens and established the earth. You sustain in being all that is. In Christ, your Son, our life and yours are brought together. He made his home among us that we might forever dwell in you. Through your Holy Spirit, you call us to new birth in a creation restored by love. May this life-giving Spirit, who spoke through Moses and the prophets, who descended upon Jesus in the River Jordan and upon the apostles on the day of Pentecost, transfigure this thanksgiving meal, that this bread and wine may become for us the body and blood of Christ, and we may be kindled with the fire of your love and renewed for the service of your kingdom. May this Creator Spirit accomplish the words of your beloved Son, who on the night in which he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." United by one baptism, in the same Holy Spirit and the same body of Christ, we pray together now and say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Jesus told his apostles, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you always." The bread which we break is the communion in the body of Christ. The cup of blessing for which we give thanks is the communion in the blood of Christ. Take, eat. This is the body of Christ broken for you. Do this in remembrance of him. This cup is the new covenant in the blood of Christ. Drink from it, all of you, in remembrance of him. The gifts of God to his people. Let us pray. Almighty God, we give thanks for this sacrament in bread and wine, symbols of a life shared, a life given, a life sacrificed. And Christ, the Master Carpenter, who at the last through wood and nails purchased our salvation, wield well your tools in this, the workshop of your world, that we who come rough-hewn to this bench may be fashioned to a truer beauty by your word. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hymn 419. Thine be the glory, risen conquering Son. Now go in peace, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you and all whom you love this Easter day and always.
Thank you. life and death.